Hi, my name is Sylvain Allais from University of Quebec in Chicoutimi in Canada. And in the next half hour, I'm going to talk to you about a new concept called Cooperative Runtime Monitoring of Interface Contracts. What you're going to see are the slides for the presentation I gave at the 14th EDOC conference in Brazil in October of 2010, which incidentally won the Best Paper Award there, so I hope you'll enjoy. I shall first mention that if you want any further information about the contents of this talk, you can visit my website at the address shown, where you can download a copy of the paper for that presentation and also the slides themselves. And of course, please don't hesitate to contact me if you have any questions or ideas on this topic or any other subject I'm working on. Before we start, let's first agree on a couple of terms I'll use during this presentation. We're going to talk a lot about the client, which in this talk will designate the consumer of some resource, functionality, or service, and the server, which provides it. Of course, there has to be some form of communication between the two through messages, so we'll have a client first sending what we'll call a request message, and the server answering by returning a response message. And of course, there will be a long-running interaction, which means that the client and the server typically exchange multiple request and response messages. Now, we don't precise what these messages are made of, so we'll designate them abstractly as just, say, letters. However, we know in advance what all the possible messages between a client and a server can be, so we can represent this set as some form of alphabet. So here, just for fun, I represent them as Scrabble letters. A trace or message trace is simply a sequence of such messages. So suppose you define some kind of protocol using, say, a finite state machine, then most probably a lot of different traces will lead you to the same state of this machine. So in a way, we can say that a state is an abstraction of a trace according to some protocol. If you have such a protocol, you can define a transition function, which is a function that, given any message from the alphabet, and any state from the set of possible states will return either the new state of the protocol resulting from the sending or reception of the message, or some empty symbol that expresses the fact that in the current state of the protocol, sending or receiving that message is not defined or not allowed. We can express this mathematically by saying that delta is a function from the set of messages and states to the set of states. And we can extend that definition by saying that if we give delta a sequence of messages, then its return value is simply the repeated application of delta on each message successively from some predefined initial state, which is marked as S0 in this slide. Now we have a way of specifying, of all possible traces of messages, which ones are valid according to the protocol embedded into the definition of delta. The interface contract is just the function which, given any trace, returns either true if that trace complies with the protocol and false otherwise. And more formally, we can say that the function will return true for a given sequence of messages if and only if applying the transition function on that sequence does not return the empty symbol. That is, it leads us somewhere that is defined by the protocol. Okay. Now that we have defined this basic terminology, we can revisit the original scenario of a client and a server interacting through messages that must follow some interface contract, and we can see how it can model a range of different contexts. For example, in an object-oriented programming language such as Java, one can think of the server as an instance of some class, say iterator, the client as a Java program that uses that instance, and the messages as method calls and return values. Then the interface contract defines valid sequences of methods one can call on an instance of the iterator. We have an example here that says that two calls of the next method on the same instance of an iterator must be separated by at least one occurrence of method hasNext. That is, you should always check whether the iterator can return a new element before asking for that element. We can see that this is indeed a natural constraint on the use of an iterator, and that it involves sequences of method calls. It is not a property that you can express or check by looking at method calls individually. Second example, in the context of web services, we can repeat the same process of mapping each part of the figure to concrete elements. In this case, the server is a web service. whose functionalities are consumed by a client, like a JavaScript client, running in a user's web browser. And the interaction is made through the exchange of documents in the XML format, so XML messages. I took here the example of the Amazon e-commerce service, which allows clients to manipulate the contents of a virtual shopping cart made of items from the Amazon catalog. You can do many things with the shopping cart, but there are also things that you can't do. One example is that if you invoke the cart clear operation in a message, then you cannot modify the contents of the cart or remove items from it until you actually add a new item to the cart. Now, this is pretty natural. It doesn't make sense to try to modify or remove items from an empty cart. Of course, one might wonder what happens when we stray away from what an interface contract tells us to do. And the answer depends on the context. But in general, we can expect error messages from the server's part. In addition, since we jump outside what was designed, then basically anything can happen. So we might as well obtain a response that makes us think that everything is fine, but actually contains nonsensical data. This might also trigger compensation mechanisms, exception handling, things like that. And in general, what we get is a waste of processing time doing all these things and potentially even security problems. Now, the big question then becomes, how do we prevent a client-server exchange of messages from going outside the interface contract? In particular, we are asking this question from the server side. So the server is interested in preventing the client from producing messages that violate the contract. Of course, we could ask the same question by reversing the roles, but in the scenarios I've just shown, so Java programming and the Amazon web service, we assume that the server works correctly and that if a violation is to occur, it is the client's fault. There are currently three solutions to this problem. The first one is to perform what I called a priori certification, where some trustworthy authority on behalf of the server checks the client and tries to ensure in advance that it behaves according to the contract. This can be done through testing, static verification, any method that can give the server compelling reasons to believe that the client is correct. Once this is done, the authority gives the client some kind of digital certificate, which is a document that asserts that the client has been checked and satisfies the server's requirements. The trick is that once this testing is done, the client is simply required to present that certificate to the server upon starting an interaction. The server checks the certificates, and if it's deemed valid, it lets the client start the interaction. The server doesn't need to perform any other verification on the client itself at runtime, which is nice. An example of such a process is the certification of iPhone applications by Apple. If you develop an application for the iPhone, you must then submit it to Apple, which eventually certifies it and puts it on its online store. iPhones are designed not to accept any application that doesn't come along an Apple certificate. All this is very fine, but for one thing, it supposes that the client cannot change once it has been certified, or that you cannot circumvent the certification mechanism, which in reality is hard to achieve. For example, for iPhones, this is called jailbreaking. It basically consists of hacking the phone's operating system so that it stops requiring a certificate to let an application run. In the case of web applications, you have JavaScript prototype hijacking that allows you to replace the application's original code with whatever you want at runtime so that the code that has been checked is not the one that runs when the interaction with the server starts. Of course, you can set up additional mechanisms like verifying that the code that runs is the one that has been certified at runtime, but this somehow defeats the point of performing the check in advance. An alternate solution is to perform monitoring of the interface contract itself at runtime, say on the server side. You set up a separate process at the server's entrance, whose job is to check every incoming message from the client against the interface contract. The process lets the message through to the server itself only if it complies with the contract, and otherwise it discards it. This way you shield the server from any junk, so to speak, from the client, and the server is ensured that anything that ever comes in has been checked and follows the contract. This comes at a price, though, and it can become a bottleneck if the single entry point has to check incoming messages from a large number of client instances. Very well, then. We can come up with a third solution that simply flips the image and sends the monitoring process on each instance of the client. So client-side monitoring. This way, bad messages are filtered before they are even sent to the server, which in turn doesn't have any processing to do. Moreover, each client is responsible for the monitoring of its own instance of the message exchange so that the processing load is evenly spread across all clients. So this seems like a nice solution. But obviously, having the client watch its own messages is a bit strange. And in particular, it doesn't provide too many guarantees to the server that any monitoring is done at all. You see, in this scenario, the server totally relies on the fact that clients can be trusted. But that's